words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus has already, before this, told them what is coming. Mary has anointed his feet. They have shared a final supper together. He has washed their feet, foretold the betrayal, and Judas has left. He's given them a new commandment, foretold Peter's denial, and tried once again to help them understand where he's going. As we heard last Sunday, Jesus promised he would draw them to himself and that they would know his way. It has been a heavy and dynamic, strange few days for the disciples, for those closest to him, and this day all the more so. This is Jesus giving words of love and direction and comfort as they live out this final goodbye, as we say in English, which is an apt expression arising from God be with you, goodbye. We know it's not the final goodbye, but they don't yet. You know, we have them all the time in our life. Usually our goodbyes are pretty casual. My favorite ones end in, okay, see you Sunday. The more important goodbyes call for more preparation. As we see a loved one take a trip that we'll maybe worry about, as we watch children or grandchildren graduate, send them off into new adventures, as we say goodbye to a coworker, to dear friends moving away, who will no longer sit next to us in pew or choir, no more weed alongside us or break bread together. So perhaps we might tuck a little surprise into a suitcase, maybe offer a parting gift to remember each other by. It is especially significant when one is dying, and we often will recall stories of shared life and hold it between us as a gift. Even if they can't hear us, we pray with them, hold their hand, share in mutual comfort. These all have in common what is happening in this gospel lesson between Jesus and those closest to him. Know my love, and I will be with you in spirit. Jesus is leaving them and prepares them by emphasizing their shared love, and that such love means they and we live his commandments. He also promises they're not being cut adrift in his death. God will send them the advocate, in Greek, paraclete. It's also called the Holy Comforter, Helper, Counselor, the Spirit of Truth, Jesus says, to be with them forever. There are a couple of translation peculiarities in this passage, and the first is less substantive, so we'll look at it first. The paraclete, advocate, helper, Jesus says God is sending, is not identified with any gender at all. Even though by tradition, Bibles speak in this passage saying he or him in reference to the paraclete, the Greek word autos can be either he, him, she, her, it, they, them, or even the same self. Biblical Greek's personal pronouns were way ahead of our email signatures, and people rarely know this. The second translation stumble is the word paraclete itself. It is more a transliteration, often translated as it is today, advocate, yet no one English word can quite replace what it really means to my thinking. Para means alongside, immediately. Kletos, to call for, to call in aid. This is a change in John's way of speaking of the Holy Spirit. Until now, and in the other three Gospels, the Spirit is always pneuma, wind, breath, Spirit with a small s or Spirit with a large s. Pneuma descended at Jesus' baptism. He tells Nicodemus he must be born of water and pneumatos. Tells the Samaritan woman, God is pneuma, gives life, and so on. So here John, and only John, uses paraclete, and the emphasis changes from pneuma to paraclete, and it emphasizes the help the paraclete will bring them. The change is significant because of Jesus' impending departure. Even though the paraclete is coming to help us here, he promises he will also be that help for us in the world to come. Jesus is integrating what they may so far have perceived as separate, the love of God, the love which they are commanded to live out, and the Spirit's helping presence which surpasses all goodbyes. I will not leave you orphaned, he says. Surely the disciples took some comfort in this. And more so John's early church audience, who were living with persecution and certainly some fear of Jesus having risen and gone and abandoned them after the resurrection. Notice, though, that Jesus describes this as another advocate, not the one and only, another. That is to say, Jesus was the first, the one who came to us in the incarnation, in the flesh, so that we might know God's relational, sacrificial love for us, and know it includes keeping his commandments. We often talk about being Christ's hands and heart in the world, and as such, we obey him. When we comfort and encourage one another, when we're present even when we can't understand what someone we love is going through, we can't fix it or explain it or chase a crisis away, even in saying goodbye to each other, be it with tears or laughter, silence or awe, we're part of the living, moving Spirit, the comforter's comfort in each other's lives. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, which are that you love one another as I have loved you. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples. Jesus ties love to obedience here, which may have made sense and worked so much more easily in their day. I don't know. But I do see it's not an easy thing for us to embrace. I'm pretty rarely called obedient, and I don't look at a lot of you and think that either. It doesn't seem to be a high value in our culture. Yes, it's good for our dogs, the one we're training at home right now. But we ourselves shy away from that. It seems not independent and personal drive enough. Here's what enlightens us, though. To obey his commandments is a sign of love. And it's a defining mark of those who are his disciples. A sign of love and a mark of those who follow him. The love that Jesus commands is not about just affectionate feelings, which cannot be commanded. He calls for this agape love, which is loving others through action, sometimes called brotherly love. There's no list of rules to accomplish it, to check off to see if we're doing it right. There's no certificate to post on our wall, be it virtual or otherwise. We have to live it. Listen, consider, what is the way to embody Jesus' love for the sake of another? The act of following Jesus' commandments oblige us to allow him to reshape our lives. I want to turn to the Acts of the Apostles reading we heard this morning. Paul is speaking to the people in Athens. And we hear he arrived there and was disturbed to find a city full of idols. So he spends his time in debate and conversation, arguing, which is a delightful pastime for him and for them. Athenians especially prided themselves on their intellect and were known for inquiring of new ideas. And they deem Paul worthy of holding his own because they invite him to the Areopagus to speak. Think for a musician, you've been invited to Carnegie Hall. He begins by using Greek philosophy to tailor his message to this group in front of him so that they can hear it in familiar terms. He comes alongside of them to speak of their altar to an unknown god and uses it as a way into helping them see what he sees. Now, likely that altar was the Athenians' attempt to avoid leaving any god out, just in case, and lest that god be offended and bring on some retaliation. As Paul talks, he shifts it from that of the unknown god to the god he knows, and that they can too. The God which they are all children of. He waits, though, until the very end to tie his points together and speak of this man appointed by God and raised from the dead. We don't know how many heard him that day or how many were persuaded to look at things with their minds changed. And even so, I see this as one of, if not the best teaching moment from Paul, and a marvelous example for us. He makes God in Christ known in their own ways and in their context. For him, this is loving Christ and living in obedience to his commandments. Now I look out and I see many of you who do this as well. Maybe not so overtly or as wordy, but I see you do it in serving, in hospitality, in creating beautiful things, in taking care of each other, in taking care of this place dedicated to God. We do it in countless ways. As we travel alongside of others in this agape love, we too become paracletes. Brother Luke Dietwig, Society of St. John the Evangelist, writes about our daily need for the power of Jesus' resurrection in order to face tomorrow. Offering this to another may not engage right away, yet we still plant it. He writes, resurrection comes small, like seeds and leaven. One little word of encouragement, one affirmation, perhaps evoking one smile or laugh. One little gift can change us. Each time a new set of readings comes along that I'll be preaching on, I ask myself anew, what do I know about God from this text? What do I believe? So I'll tell you what the sort of simple stripped-down version was for me this week, and I'm asking you to share the same, to think of what it has been as you listen today. Share it with each other, with me, with someone. What I know, what I believe, God finds a way, bringing us as willing and well-made tools in the hand. I know our participation in such agape love grows it anew in ourselves and teaches it. I believe obedience to Jesus is not so bad, hard at times, but not bad. And to consider a guide other than ourselves or the usual secular ones is a grace-filled gift of the Spirit. And finally, I know we are never far from that Holy Comforter, from the help of the Spirit, ever. Jesus said so.